Divine Truth. Name of this presentation is What is Your Treasure? And it is part of the Human Soul series. It was presented in Murgon, Queensland, Australia on the 16th of December 2012. This is part two.
So I wanted to say something, sort of a bit of an aside to getting started again with the talk. Mary and I have decided, for a lot of reasons, that we are no longer going to tolerate anger projections coming from members of the audience in our seminars. And if we feel those projections coming from members of the audience, we're going to actually ask them to leave right at the time that we feel them in the seminars. And we've also decided that anybody who projects anger or rage with us via emails or phone calls that we sometimes get, we are also no longer going to tolerate being at our seminars until they address their issues of anger and rage with us. So if you ever find yourself being asked to leave for that one reason, it would be because we feel that you are angry with us, then my suggestion is to have some self-examination, which is what we're going to talk about in this coming session. Mary, you'd like to, if we just have the mic down for...
I just wanted to say that this is a joint decision that we've made, and I don't really feel that there's an onus on me to justify or explain the decision when I ask someone to leave. I'll explain why, I feel
that... Quite often people say, oh, I'm not angry. And we'll say, well, that's too bad. We feel you are, and you still need to leave.
Well, what I would say is we're able to disagree, but this space here is one that I've created, and I'm also able to ask someone to leave that space. And I feel okay with that. If we were in a different setting, then it would not be...
Where it's not our space.
Where it's not my space.
Then we would choose to leave.
I would leave, or exit in some way. And yeah. I feel that that we're actually acting in love towards ourselves to just make this space actually kind towards ourselves.
Yeah. Because it's very off-putting to have people in the audience projecting rage at you while you're trying to speak. I don't know if you've ever tried that yourself, but all it feels like is this barrage coming at you while you're trying to think and speak about a different subject. And it's very uncomfortable, and also something that we've been tolerating for a long period of time because we haven't loved ourselves enough, and we feel very strongly that we don't want to tolerate that anymore. So that's the reason for our decision there. Thanks, babe. So the reason why I say that is a few people have already been asked to leave today. So, how are you feeling? Now you're afraid that you're going to be asked to leave. What do you treasure? What do you treasure? If you're owning your rage, it's totally different. We're okay with you being angry but feeling your own anger. But what's often happening is that anger is being projected specifically at Mary and myself for something we've meant to have said or done that you don't agree with. And to be honest with you, you know, we're paying for the venue, we're paying for all the seats, we're paying for the seats. We don't feel it's very ethically right to have you sit in our seat at one of our venues, at one of our seminars, projecting anger and rage at us when all we're trying to do is give you a gift. And we feel that ethically is really out of harmony with love, and we feel quite strongly we're going to stop doing that with anybody who engages that. Obviously, people have anger and rage within them that they need to address, and that's fine. But if you're going to project it at us directly, then you're not owning it. We've only entered your life in the last 5 or 6 years. We're not responsible for the anger and rage that you have as a result of your childhoods or other issues. And we feel quite strongly that we need to address this issue with firmness, because we have tolerated a lot of bad behaviour, and we're not going to tolerate that bad behaviour in our own seminars. It's one thing to tolerate it when we're walking down the street, that's fine, but quite another when, you know, we've set up a venue and paid for the venue and set up everything that's happening, and then to have people being angry with us just because of something we've said. or meant to have done. In most cases, what we've said has been truthful, and in almost all cases, we've never done anything to harm anybody purposefully. And so we feel that any rage or anger is undeserved, particularly considering what we're teaching, which is own your own anger and rage, you know, like given that as well. Okay, so let's continue with our... You're finding it an interesting discussion? Yeah? About treasure. It's a very simple principle, isn't it? But quite often, it's interesting how we do not think of the simplest things sometimes. Our life gets so complicated that we finish up being drawn into all this conundrum and drama in our life without reducing our life back to some simple principles, which if we applied, our life would actually become easier and simpler to handle and manage. So, and this is one of them, I feel. Let me rub this off, which I probably should have done in our break. I can see why Mary was struggling with it yesterday. Okay. Okay. I want to read you, to start off this section, a verse. This one comes from Matthew, though, not from Luke. This is Matthew 13, verses 13 to 16, another Bible verse. It says, "This is why I speak to them by the use of illustrations, because looking, they look in vain, and hearing, they hear in vain. Neither do they get the sense of it." Does that sound like somebody? Okay. "And toward them the prophecy of Isaiah is having fulfillment, which says, by hearing you will hear, but by no means get the sense of it, and looking you will look, but by no means see. For the heart of this people has grown unreceptive, and with their ears they have heard without response. And they have shut their eyes that they might never see with their eyes and hear with their ears and get the sense of it with their hearts and turn back, and I heal them." Now, that was a quote that I actually, in the first century, quoted the book of Isaiah. I used to like reading the books of the prophets quite a lot. The reason why, of course, is that prophecy is inspired by spirits. And so I used to love being able to read what spirits had said in the past to different people on the earth that they had written down. And Isaiah was a medium or a prophet, and he received a lot of inspiration from spirits, and he wrote a lot of it down, just like many of the other prophets like Ezekiel, Jeremiah, Daniel, and so forth. And so what I did was I enjoyed mostly reading those particular books of the Bible in the first century. Of course, it wasn't a Bible then. It was just like records that were kept in the local synagogue. And I used to spend my time in the local place of learning as much as I could to learn about what these particular verses had said. I learnt a lot of them in my first 10 years of my life in the first century, and they formed the basis of many of my quotations later in my life. But this particular quotation appealed to me because I could see how closed people were to the process of self-examination. And it's the process of self-examination that is going to lead you into changing your treasure. You see, if you can't accurately measure what is currently your treasure, and I'm a poet and I didn't even know it, if you can't actually measure what is your current treasure, you will never adjust your way or your desires to have a new type of treasure, a different form of treasure. For example, in our previous illustration I gave when I was talking about fear, if you don't know that you're afraid of a certain thing and you don't realise that that particular thing is driving all of your behaviour, then of course it's highly unlikely you'll change anything that you do in order to adjust that particular behaviour. So self-reflection is a very, very important part of progression. Now, there's another verse in Isaiah that I'd like you to read. I would like to read to you. So from Isaiah 29, verses 15 and 16. And this one I read to you earlier. Woe to those who go to great depths to hide their plans from the Lord, who do their work in darkness and think, who sees us? Who will know? You turn things upside down, as if the potter were thought to be like the clay. Shall what is formed say to the one who formed it, you did not make me? Can the pot say to the potter, you know nothing? Now, I would like to particularly focus on those particular verses there where we have this concept. And in fact, in the scriptures, and particularly in the book of Isaiah likened the human soul to a clay pot being moulded by God. So that was the analogy that the spirit who guided Isaiah would often use. And so what would happen is that he was trying to get across to people that he was doing this mediumship for, that there is this basic understanding that most of us have, that we have the right to self-determination. We think that because we're given free will, that means that we become self-reliant. That's what we believe. And so many of us have become extremely self-reliant. We feel that we're the only person that we can really rely upon in our life. Now, we are the pot. In other words, we are the person being molded by God. So if you think about a potter molding, if you think about the process of molding, and how do you spell that kind of molding? No U. What is it? M-O-L. Make up your mind. Is it this one? Yeah. That's what I would have thought, but anyway. You imagine yourself as a potter, and you've got this clay in front of you. You usually have a turning wheel, don't you? I don't know if you've ever seen that done, but normally they sit down with a turning wheel. In the old days, you used to have these pedals that would turn it for you, you know, so back in our time, they used to do a lot of moulding like that, and you'd have some pedals that drove a process of rotation that you would then mould the clay. Nowadays, of course, you've got a nice little electrical motor buzzing around with an adjustable speed and everything that allows you to not speed it too fast because you'll fly apart, and or just to keep it at the right speed, not too slow, otherwise you have all sorts of other problems occurring. So you've got this moulding process, which is like a platter with a lump of clay, just a lump of clay in the middle, right? And it's spinning around. Now, if you were this potter, imagine you're the potter, you're there sitting down on this on the stool, moving the feet back and forward, whatever it is that you're doing, I don't know what that looks like, but anyway, and so you're adjusting it and around it goes. Now, you know that if you spin it too fast, those of you who've done it, what you know happens? What the shape is that you're attempting to make finishes up just flying apart, right? Collapsing, all sorts of problems. Now of course, God does not want that to happen to your soul. So God's not interested in destroying your soul while he's trying to create something. But also you know that if you don't go fast enough, there's all sorts of abrasions that occur and the surface starts coming off and you get all sorts of stickiness occurring and it's not a smooth operation. If you don't use enough water, you know, you find that if you use too much water, it all becomes floppy and flies apart. It's quite an art to the whole thing, right? And eventually, if you do things right, you end up with something that is useful, right? Of some kind, something that is useful. And then, of course, you might put that in some heat, of course, to dry it all out, the moisture, so it retains its shape and so forth. Now, that's what God's trying to do with you. God's trying to mould you into what God created you to be in the first place, or the potential of you being in the first place. The issue is that most of us have very little trust of that. Right? We believe that what we, our concept of who we are, is better than God's concept of who we could become. In other words, as that verse said in Isaiah, we believe we know better than the potter who made us. That's our problem. Our underlying problem is one of arrogance. That's the underlying problem in the human race, really. This arrogance developed right at the very inception of the colonization of this earth. And when I say colonization, two people came to this earth through the creation process with God. They went through the process of their soul enveloping bodies that God had created. And since that time, or shortly after that time, those two people, a man and a man, and when you talk with those two people, you'll find that they had these feelings that they could usurp the potter, that they could actually determine for themselves what their own pot should be, right? That's what they've basically decided. They decided that they wanted to become even more than a pot. They wanted to become God, who had the right to determine everything. They believed, because of their own internal power and what they could do in terms of manipulating matter and so forth at the time, they believed that they could become like God and not have to be governed by God's laws that are placed around the universe. So that's what they finished up believing. So this arrogance grew in them to the point where they decided that the best choice they could make is to ignore everything God was saying. In other words, they became self-reliant. They're now relying on themselves. Now, in that process, they took away the person who was forming the clay out of the equation. And now it's like the pot trying to make itself. How successful would that be if we were talking about a piece of clay? Right? So we're talking about a piece of clay. You just lump the clay on the wheel, the potting wheel, and just watch. 100 years later, still be watching. 1,000 years later, still watching. And by now it's all dried out and crumbly. And 2,000 years later, it's all shriveled and dried out. There'll still be bits of it there. And this is what's happened to human soul. Is that we've shriveled up. We've become so constrained by our own thought that we have the power to do everything ourselves, that we have gotten to this condition where what we believe is real is just so destroyed from its original creation. We cut out the hands forming the clay. That's what we've done. We did it because we have a sense of arrogance and fear about God as well. We have a lot of fear associated with God. Many of you don't realize it, but one of your primary fears about God is a fear that God will tell you what to do all the time. Many of you have not embraced any religion in the past because those religions tell you that you have to do what God tells you to do all the time. Right? And that's one of the fears that many people have about embracing religion. And I'm not suggesting we should embrace religion. I'm just saying that some of these fears that we have been in us for most of our life, right? Now, before we can have the potter involved in our life again, in other words, before we can have the hands of God moving over our soul, moulding our soul back into its potential creation, the clay has to determine one thing, and that is, does he or she want that to happen? And we have all sorts of reasons why we don't want that to happen. And this is where self-examination is such an important process. Because if we do not examine ourselves, logically, we can see that if we take the hands away of the potter who's forming the clay, in the end, we're never going to end up being the thing that God designed us to be. That makes logical sense, yes? So what we need to do is get the hands back in the process. We need to invite God back in to this process, right? And that means to start honouring all the ways in which God can be involved in the process of moulding us. Obviously, there's laws that God has that helps us to mould, that helps him to mould us. But there's also other people who God has already connected with who can help mould us. There's spirits who are in good condition that can help mould us. In fact, all of you have a guide who is there to help you mould you. Or really, if you think about it, to help God mould you back into what is the potential of what you can be. Now, the problem is that many of us are resistive to this process because we don't want to look at the reasons why we don't want the hands of God involved in our life. That makes sense? We don't want to examine ourselves to see why we are rejecting God most of the time. Right? We don't want to know why. So we're constantly trying to avoid God while at the same time telling ourselves that we want to connect to God. Right? Which is, again, a very illogical thing to do. But it's something that we do driven because of the, again, the emotions that we do not wish to feel. Now, a person who's truly into self-examination would not continue in this state. A lack of self-examination is evident through how we act. Now, this is some things that I've written down here that I'd like to just state to you as lines. Many of us are still trying to cover over badness and error that exist within us. Do you know what I mean by that? We're trying to make out that the thing that God's exposing through the different laws and through his own hands isn't really there. That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to cover over the fact of what our true condition is. Many of us think that God does not see. And some of us, and many of us actually, believe God doesn't even care enough to see. Right? Many of us feel like, you know, we're going to be quite solid when we die. Many of us feel that when we die, everything will be pretty predictable. But that's not the case for the majority of us, actually. And the reason why is because we can't see ourselves as we truly are yet. The only time your future becomes more predictable in terms of its safety and security is when you see yourself more accurately. Right? Otherwise, you're going to have a life full of very negative surprises. In other words, you'll see things happening after you pass that you never expected to happen because you never wanted to see the emotion that created it in the first place. Yeah. Now, there's only one type of development, really, that's going to help you change, and that is a development of your character and your nature. Now, if I am very invested emotionally in my current character and nature, I am going to hold on to that. And if I hold on to that, I am never going to be able to expose my true character and nature. Now, many of us don't even want to see our true character and nature. We get it pointed out to us every day, many of us, and we want to remain completely oblivious to what is happening. In other words, we're telling the potter, hands off. That's what we're doing. We're telling the potter, stay away from me. I want my own concept of me. That is not a place of self-examination. It's amazing how many conversations I have had with many of you individually where I have had to remove myself from the conversation eventually because everything I say is rejected by you, the person who's receiving the information. says, oh, no, I'm not doing that. No, I don't feel like I'm doing that. Okay. I'm a pretty easygoing person. I'm okay with you believing that if that's the way you want. But I don't feel drawn into helping people who have a lack of self-examination. Like, I've had to have a lot of self-examination, right, in my life to change. And a lot of the things haven't been that pleasant to see. Yeah. And even more difficult, haven't been very pleasant to feel. Right? But I've gone through the process that I'm encouraging you to go through. But it's very hard to encourage someone to go through something that they're not even aware they need to go through in the first place and do not want to be aware of what they need to go through. And this is where it gets down to that sincere treasure. If my treasure is my relationship with God, I will be drawn automatically into self-examination. Now, what I would like to do is read you out some accounts. These are all things that have happened in the last few weeks to myself and Mary. And some of them, you might know the people involved, and I'm sorry if I embarrass any of you as a result of this. I'm not going to mention the names of the people involved, but unfortunately some of you may know them, and there's not much I can do about that. But I want to list a number of different things that have gone on, just to give an example of a lack of self-examination. Because you'd be surprised how often in a course of any conversation where self-examination is just not present at all. Okay. I went to get a haircut a few weeks ago with my hairdresser, and she's a person who's heard the divine truth and knows about the divine truth, and she has an arrangement with us where we give her a gift rather than her asking for money to do our haircut. She usually does a very good job of our haircut. As normal, I sit down to have my hair cut, and she starts asking me questions about her personal life. And she stated that she felt that she had a very low sense of self-worth. How many of you feel that you have a low sense of self-worth? Right? Quite a lot, right? And she was trying to convince me that she had a low sense of self-worth. And I finished up having to say something to her about it. I just said, well, I'm sorry, but I disagree. I actually feel that you believe you're more valuable than most other people who you meet, and that you actually believe you're more valuable than I am. And she goes, what? I can't agree with that. And she wanted to protest at that. And I said, would you like to know how I know that? And she said, yes, as she often does. Well, this is the first way. Here's a bit of math for you. When I go and get my hair cut from her, I normally give her from $38 is the minimum I've given her for my haircut, to around $50. That's what I normally give her for my haircut. Right? Now, it takes her around 20 minutes to one half of an hour to do my haircut. But let's say it takes one half an hour. That means that I give her the equivalent of $100 per hour of her time for doing my haircut. That make sense? Okay. Many of you are thinking that's a fairly pricey haircut. It's not a pricey haircut if it's a good haircut. Yeah. Anyway, in addition, while she's doing my hair, she asks me a heap of questions about her personal life, which I answer straightforwardly. So I'm actually giving her a consulting session on her personal life for one half an hour as well, which of course I do not charge for, but give it as a gift. So, but that's the value that I place on her. I asked her what she normally charges per hour for her haircuts. And she said she normally charges $40 per hour. So I value her at 2.5 times what she values her in terms of her time. That's not the value I placed on a soul, that's the value I've placed on her time. Does that make sense? I have valued her time at 2.5 times what she values her time. So I love her and value her, even with her time, to at least 2.5 times what she values herself. Does that make sense? These are my actions, and they prove, as I said earlier, what you do proves your value. What you do proves everything. Okay, so once I pointed that out to her, she had a bit of a cry, and of course there was a bit of a slip up with her hair and so forth, but that's what you take when you're having your hair cut, right? Okay. Okay. Now, I then asked her that when she gives me a gift for my time, what does she give me? So she came, many times we have discussions about her personal life and so forth. During those times, she does not give me anything at all. But she does come along to the seminars sometimes, right? And during those times, she told me that she gives me around $30 for 4 hours of my time. Right? So what's that work out to be? $7.50 per hour. That's how she values my time. Right? So I value her time at $100 per hour, and she values my time at $7.50 per hour. And then I said to her, so what do you have more value of? Can you honestly say you value me when this is the equation? Now, how many of you would be pretty confronted with that conversation? Yeah. Well, there was a bit more slips on the hair. understandably, perhaps. Yeah. You see, she's demonstrating, actually, that she, in her personal life, and this is not a judgment, it's just a statement of truth about what I've already taught you today. Remember I said at the beginning of this, look at how you spend your time, what goes on with your time. And the beauty of doing an equation like this is you start seeing the reality of how you feel. And you also start seeing a lot of reasons why you feel how you feel. Does that make sense? So here, she's basically telling me, if I was took offence quite easily, you could see that I could take offence there, couldn't I? She's valuing me at around 12 times less than she values herself. That's pretty significant, isn't it? Yeah. And this is why I couldn't agree with her that she actually had low self-worth. Because in the equation, it would appear that I had the lowest self-worth. Because I continue to give her things that she does not value as much as she values her own activity. But it also tells me that that was the value she was placing on divine truth. And this is what I said to her. $7.50 per hour is how she values divine. By the way, that's higher than the many of you value divine truth, ironically. Right? Many of you value it less than that, yes, in terms of what you actually give. So it's still higher than many. But in comparison to how she valued a haircut, divine truth was 12 times less. Is it 12 times? 12, it's more than that. So, is anyone going to calculate? It's a bit more than 12, isn't it? 12 and something. But let's say it's 12 times less, just round around. Now, can such a person then claim that divine truth is the most important thing in their life? Of course not. Can such a person even claim that they honour me as much as they honour themselves? Of course not, because they don't. They don't honour my time as much as they honour their own time. Right? Can you see, what I'm pointing out to you is she had the belief that she honoured me more than she honoured herself. But the reality, just in looking at that one equation of how she values time, proves that that's not the case. And in fact, I then asked her, what does she get from her haircuts that she does not get from divine truth? Because that's the reason why she values it. and she gets approval. She's quite a good hairdresser. A lot of people go to her. They honour her time. She gets to feel honoured. She gets to feel like loved through the process, gets to feel a bit special through the process, gets a whole lot of emotions. Now, the trouble with divine truth is it doesn't give you any of those emotions because it's often quite confronting. You see? It's the emotions that drive the value. Where the heart is, that's where the treasure will be. Right? The treasure and the heart are linked together. Right? And her treasure is on feeling the emotions that giving haircuts gives her. And that is more important to her currently than the divine truth and what that gives her. What that gives her is a lot of thinking problems, having to work things out, having to act differently, having to confront her own behaviour. You know, there are things that she doesn't get any addictions met from. And so, of course, she's not going to value it as much as she values giving haircuts. And, of course, how are you going to value who you hear the divine truth from if you don't actually value the divine truth itself? So how am I going to value my hairdresser if I don't value the job she does for me? Can you see? It's impossible, isn't it? If I value my hairdresser, then I will value the time she spends doing my hair. I will value the job she does. If you value divine truth, you'll also value where it came from. And it might not be from me, by the way, that it came from. It might be other people who shared it to you. You'll value them the rest of your life. Do you know what I mean? How many of you are here because Peter invited you to come to something? Peter Heiblin. Right? So there's a good 10 or 15. So you could say Peter has multiplied himself through his desire to share. Does that make sense? You can see that? So many of you, for a long time in the future, will value the fact that he brought you to the truth that you now appreciate. So, what do you feel about that equation? Any comments? Graham, thanks.
If the hairdresser had some technology where she could cut 100 people's hair at the same time, would you still give her $100 per hour?
I would value her at what I feel it is worth. See, I feel she's worth that at the moment. That's what I feel a haircut's worth to me, a good haircut.
But if she was doing 99 people at the same time as she was doing
I'd still give her $100 if it was still the same haircut, yeah.
Okay.
Why would I not? Just because she's bought a mechanical device that doesn't cut off your ears in the process or something. Well, why wouldn't I? You see, to me it makes no difference. It's my value that I'm placing on it, not theirs. Do you follow that? It's my value that I'm placing on it, right? Now, my personal feelings about the haircut is that it's a lot less valuable than divine truth. That's my personal feelings, but it's not hers. And what I pointed out to her, that it isn't hers, even though she was claiming that it was. You see? She was also claiming that she valued me more than she valued herself. And I said I couldn't agree with that. And I had proof. This is proof that she doesn't value me more than she values herself. And that's okay with me. I'm not saying that she needs to change or anything. I'm just pointing out the truth of the fact to her. Does that make sense? Any other? Alex, up there.
I haven't touched upon any abundance emotions or issues at all, but I find it highly offensive to compare someone's worth to a piece of paper. And I realise I have a rage towards money. I'm finding it resistive.
Yeah, and I don't have a rage towards money, so I can actually do this. And I don't also have a rage towards her for valuing me less than she values herself. She does have a rage towards men about not valuing her as much as what she values herself. But I don't feel that towards her. See, a lot of this rage prevents even this kind of analysis. Do you understand? We get so embroiled in the feelings that we have about it that we're not even able to logically think about what's really going on half the time. We need to get rid of that rage. So I feel you need to get rid of the rage towards money. And once you do, you'll recognise the reasons why it was created. And there are a lot of positive reasons why it was created. It's just being misused a lot. But there are positive reasons. It allows all of us to have a sense of what something is valued, how something is valued, or what it's worth. It helps me even make this comparison, ironically. And that in itself, if somebody learnt from that, and wow, that's the comparison, then wouldn't it be a wonderful thing? The money's been very helpful in helping them grow. Yeah. So I don't feel any of those feelings towards money, riches, fame, whatever a person wants to have. It's up to them what they want to have. I feel, though, that it is very valuable to compare the sense of worth, right? So that a person can see the truth about themselves. That's what I'm pointing out. Yep. We come down the front. Enjoy down the front this side. Enjoy start with stuff.
It just highlights for me with a lot of clarity how emotionally invested we can be to the addiction, whether we're being paid for it or not.
Yeah, the thing that really struck her when I was speaking with her about this was how emotionally invested she was in being a hairdresser and how large that investment was in compared to growing her own soul. Like, the comparison just struck her instantly, and for that reason it was a great conversation, I thought. Yeah.
AJ, I'm just wondering if the haircut would be for free, would you still go to her?
The haircut was for free.
Yeah, but you still paid some money for that, right?
Because I appreciate her.
She didn't ask that money from her?
No.
From you?
No, she never asked any money from me.
Ah, so she's not a professional hairdresser, is she?
She is.
So is she working in the salon? Or?
No, she has her own salon.
Okay. Thanks.
She's a professional hairdresser. She never asked any money from me. Would you ask money from me when I'm paying 2.5 times what you would normally ask?
No, I just didn't get it. So, yeah, just... Yeah.
You see, no hairdresser ever asked money from me because I always give them more than what they'd normally ask. Yeah, but that is a bit self-serving, is it not? Okay, we're all right with that example? Can you see the point I'm making is about self-examination? We resist self-examination so much that we cannot even logically analyse what is actually going on in any situation. We want to tell ourselves that we appreciate things when we don't. We want to tell ourselves that we have a huge amount of gratitude when our actions demonstrate we don't. How many times has that happened in a relationship? Between a man and a woman, or between a male and a female, doesn't really matter. In a relationship, how many times is it that you say, yes, I really do appreciate that, when your actions demonstrating right at that moment that you do not? It's very frequent, trust me. Okay, let's go on. And remember, these are all just things that, you know, we could pull out heaps of examples. But I just wanted to give you some kind of illustration of the different kinds of analysis you can do to help yourself work through the issues of why you don't want to analyze yourself and grow and change your treasure. You see, if you can't see what your treasure currently is, it's highly unlikely that you're going to change it. If you can't be honest about what it currently is, how are you ever going to be... know what to do to change it. Now that my hairdresser is aware that she actually values herself more than others, she can now contemplate that, can't she? She can now examine that, she can feel about why, she can work out what the haircut's giving her in terms of emotions that she can't get from divine truth, what kind of addictions are being fulfilled through the process, and she can work out also why she feels much stingier towards myself than what she expects me to give her. So what she would expect me to give her was $40 an hour, or $20 for my haircut, right? That's what she would expect from me, but she doesn't expect the same thing from herself when she's coming to one of my seminars. So there's an ethical issue there as well. There's so many issues that she could look at just in that one equation. Issues of self-examination which could help her grow towards God. That's what I'm saying. Okay, let's look at number two. Now, myself and a number of others, Luli and Igor and Lena, are often given disc to copy. Lately, I've been doing a lot of the disc copying. But often the discs are given with data on them, right? So we're providing a free service, but then we've got to get the disc, we've got to go through the disc and see what data is on it, and then we've got to work out what we're going to do with this data. Do we take the data off, or do we can't reformat the drive? If we've got 500 gigs of data that we've got to put on it, and it's only a 500 gig drive and there's already 150 gigs of data on there, then, you know, we really have to copy things individually, email them back to say, you know, what do you want copied, because we can't put all of the files on there, and so forth and so forth. It just goes on and on and on. And we're providing a free service, and many of you believe that because we're providing a free service, it means we should also do a heap of additional work for you in order to make that service happen. And this is an illustration. I had an interaction with another member of our audience where a disc was given to me. It had 500 gigabytes of a drive. And now on our website, it says only give us discs 750 gigabytes or larger. But this one was given to us 500 gigabytes. Now, at that time, I could just fit our entire system on that drive. However, on the drive was 130 gigabytes of private data. Right? So I had to now look at the drive. I had to make a decision. Was I going to delete everything on the drive? But what if what they'd given me, they'd already, you know, they were using for other things, and, you know, I don't want to delete their information and so forth. So I had to just choose what I'm going to selectively copy on the drive. Now, this is a process that normally takes me about 5 minutes of my time because I've automated the entire process. And now it's taken me already 15 minutes to work out what's going on. And then I also then had to email back the person, ask them what they want to do, wait for their reply, and on it goes, right? Anyway, I decided instead of doing all of that, I would email the person about their unloving behaviour. Now, this person responded really well to my email, but this was my email. I'm now doing the hard disk drive copying service. You left us a hard disk drive to copy, but have not followed the instructions on the net about it. For example, you gave us a drive with a total space of 500 gigabytes and with over 130 gigabytes of space used, which means that there are only 370 gigabytes free. This means that we must, one, delete everything on the drive, or two, selectively copy to the drive. This, of course, will take a very long time. Of course, deleting everything on the drive wouldn't take a long time, but selectively copying the data takes a long time because you have to be there copying each file when it's finished, copy another file. It could take you a whole day. Remember, we've got 500 gigabytes of data. We're talking about, like, there's something like 480 videos. 480 videos, you know, there's about 2,000 sound files. There's, like, it's huge amounts of data. And if you've got to selectively copy it one by one, it's going to take you forever. I said, this, of course, will take a very long time, and I cannot do it for you. In addition, I do not know if the data on this drive is important to you or not, so I don't want to delete it. You need to think about the lack of consideration and therefore lack of love in the manner in which you gave me the drive. This necessitates me using my time to analyse the drive, ask you what to do about the drive, communicate with you about the problems with the drive, wait for your response, inquire about how the drive is to be returned to you, and use this time writing this email to you, travelling to the post office in order to post it back to you, and so forth. Right? So you imagine, if you had to do all those things, how much time would you be using? Now, the donation at the time was $20 along with the drive. Right? So I'm not sure what that was for, and I haven't asked the person involved, and he doesn't need to worry about it either. Right? This is how I feel. He doesn't need to worry about it. If you had provided written instructions, then I would not have had to ask these questions nor had to waste the use of my time. If you wish to receive the disc update, then please make sure that you follow the instructions about it on the net. Also, you have not left instructions about how you are going to get the drive back. You're placing a lot of work onto people who are giving you a service for free. Even if you consider your donation of $20 as a fee for service, I have already used up that amount of time just looking at the drive and writing this email to you. Some things for you to consider. Cheers, mate. Now, the man involved did consider those things, and I got a lovely email in response from him. I actually finished up taking the drive to his home because he lived in Kingaroy, and our post office is in Kingaroy. So it's pointless me posting it. I might as well just drop it off at his house. So I left it at his house. Now, what's going on there, do you feel? Where's the self-examination, or the lack of self-examination there? If you start with Joy.
An expectation of others doing for you, it's lack of self responsibility.
Yep. It's also, isn't it also not considering what might be involved?
Not even wanting
to know?
No, just here's a disc and...
Here's a disc and you'll do it for me and here's $20 and that should cover it for the postage.
Yeah.
Yep. And sure, it would cover the postage. Yep. But not any time or effort or anything else, nor will it cover any issue to do with, you know, the interaction that then had to go on. Yep.
And it totally disregards any value for the material.
I agree, it does, yep. Mind you, the material's for free and we're happy to give it for free, yep. Natalie, thanks.
Pass it. when you were saying it, it feels like to me that when we're offered something for free, we didn't have any value in it for a start.
Oftentimes.
It didn't cost us anything. There was no effort required on our part to accumulate. And it highlights to me just how much we're willing to take consistently, and especially from those people who offer their time and their service.
Especially from the people who are willing to give.
Yes.
This is something that I'd like to address with you, actually, from a point of self-examination. Oftentimes, we pay people who are not willing to give, while at the same time not giving anything to the people who are willing to give. Do you know what my opinion is? It would be much more ethical to give money to the people who are willing to give and to withhold money from the people who are not willing to give. That would be more ethical. It would actually also confront their emotions more. But often it's the rage or anger in people who are demanding that we respond to the most. And the people who are friendly, easygoing, and do things for us without thinking, we often don't value what they do as a result. Yeah. So there's some self-examination there that needs to go. This will all interfere, won't it, with our relationship with God? Because if I'm doing that, if I'm treating you like you're worth less than me, then I don't have God's opinion of you. And if I don't have God's opinion of you, I can never become at one with God, ever. Yeah?
Just you saying how that interferes with our relationship with God, I recall a time out at the Learning Centre at Wilkesdale once where I saw you receiving God's love and I saw you giving back love to God.
Mm-hmm.
And it made me question in myself, I'm forever asking God for love, but how often do I actually, from my heart, genuinely love God back?
Yeah.
And voluntarily, not because it's been given to me and I feel overwhelmed by it, so therefore I have gratitude, but how often do I walk around with the feeling of gratitude and love for God in my heart?
Yeah, with other people in particular, we most of us would like to be loved by them before we love them. That's the reality. We want to be loved by somebody before we will love anybody. Now, God loved us first. There's a lovely verse in the Bible that speaks about the fact that God loved us first. Hence, we need to consider taking action to love in return. Does that make sense? But we often don't. We often don't consider those particular things. And what does this say? It says that a person's convenience is more important than the truth. So in the case of this example, the convenience of the individual involved was more important to him than the truth itself was to him. Does that make sense to everyone? And often, if you reflect upon your own life, that's often the case too. Like, how many times have we made a seminar at a location that you don't like? Quite often, actually. You remember when we were over on the coast, we had that lovely venue where people could come to at Butterham. It was a generous donation of the Patello family, and it was just such a lovely venue to come to. Most of us didn't appreciate it. That's the reality. That's the reason why you don't have it anymore, pretty much, because we don't appreciate these things. We don't appreciate the gifts. We often even think that, oh, the person's rich, they should give it. Or the person knows how to do it, why don't they do it? The person knows what to do, why don't they do it? I'd have to find out. I don't want to find out. They know already, why can't they do it for me? And these are all demonstrating unloving conditions. Yep. Okay. One lady, over a period of a year or so, we gave her around 200 DVDs for her personal use. We answered many of her very demanding emails, and when I say we, both Mary, myself and Luli were involved in answering many of her emails. She donated a total of $80 for over that entire time. So our costs in DVDs, without our time involved, far exceeded the donations that we received from her. Now, she wrote us, myself and Mary, and she wanted us to answer some interview-based questions. And we told her that unless she was willing to do it in a public setting with videos, that we couldn't do that because we wanted to use our time more wisely. We couldn't just keep on answering individuals' questions over and over again without it benefiting more than just the individual. We want it to benefit a lot of people. So Mary explained all of this to her. She ignored absolutely everything Mary said to her and actually requested again, and this time sent the list of her questions, which she said would only take 10 or 15 minutes to answer. And of course, you know, her 10 or 15 minutes to answer compared to the actual answers, she's asked nearly, 80 or 70 questions, I think it was. It was quite a lot. I can't remember how many questions. And she sort of expected us to answer them all in writing in 15 minutes. Mary wrote back to her and said, no, we cannot do that. We've told you we cannot do that before. And the reason why we've told you the reason, and now you're just ignoring what we're saying and ignoring the fact that we have our life and we're allowed to choose what we do with our time. The lady, of course, didn't respect any of this. She wrote back an angry email attacking us and saying now she's found out our real character and nature. And now she's never going to listen to Divine Truth again, and she's going to get on forums and tell other people about how bad her interaction was with us and so forth. So I wrote back to her and told her how selfish she was and that I was actually now going to put every single interaction that I'd had with her on the net because she was willing to go public with all of these things. I was willing to go public with how the truth was. So I did that. She then wrote back to me. She wrote back and she actually started to take legal action against me for placing the record of her actual transactions, the actual things she'd said, on the internet. So this is not a person who's very interested in openness and truth, right? Now, because of the different legal things that happened, I had to remove from the website the actual record of truth of what actually happened. Right? Now, it didn't worry me too much because all I did was put in its place my own writing of what the truth of what actually happened. So I don't think she accomplished much in the end. But why did she do it? Why did she do all of that? So she now dislikes myself intensely, and Mary also dislikes her intensely. She now has taken efforts to slander us and so forth. She's talked to other people about us and how bad we are and, you know, how disappointing it all is and all that kind of stuff. After watching, she told us personally that she's watched more than 40 videos. I would suggest she hasn't learnt very much in watching those 40 videos. But what is the underlying problem? Di, thanks.
She values herself above everybody else.
Yes. We told her that, actually. We even were loving enough to say to her that this is what is happening.
And she values herself and her own needs above God and God's truth.
Yes. What else? Sandra?
Her addiction was not being met.
Yes. So what was her addiction?
The demand to have it her way.
You know what her addiction is? Her desire to maintain her facade that she was a loving person. And as soon as I confronted, or Mary confronted first, and then I confronted that desire of hers to maintain the facade, she went into this huge panic and rage as a result. Her desire to maintain a facade was so important to her that eventually I exposed her facade on the internet in a law of attraction event, just in place of truth, and she even attacked that exposure in order to avoid her facade. What did she value? Her own opinion of herself above what the truth was demonstrating to her. That's what she valued. Where was her treasure? In her own opinion of herself. That's her treasure. You know, many of us can learn from that because we have a very similar viewpoint sometimes, that our own opinion of ourselves is our treasure, and that's what we're holding on for. The life, we're going to hold on to it to the end of time. We're going to hold on. Do you know how many spirits there are in the hills who are doing that? They're still doing that. I've got friends from the first century who are still doing that, sitting in the hills in all this torment, still holding on to their own opinion that they're right. That?
Just going back to the hairdressing person for a moment, you said that her belief was that she had very low self-worth, and then you demonstrated to her that she didn't.
I didn't say she didn't have low self-worth. I'm just saying to her that she felt other people were worth less than her.
Yep. So then with this lady, is it fair to say that she believes that her demands and needs are justifiable because I want to grow and learn in maintaining the facade?
But she also believes that she can demand our time, that she should be able to manipulate how we use our time. She believes that she should be able to control our life. Yeah. Because otherwise she would never have gotten upset about us saying no.
Yeah.
She would have gone, oh, yeah, it was an opportunity and no worries. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Like if I come to you and I say, Nat, can you help me this week doing some work at home? And you say, no, AJ, I don't want to. I'd go, no worries.
Yeah.
I wouldn't get angry with you.
Yeah.
Right? That's what she's done in return. What she's done is, in terms of the same thing she's done, she's come to Nat and said, would you be able to help me this week or something at home? And Nat's gone, no. And she goes, you terrible bitchy person. And all this stuff comes out of her because...
Yeah, okay.
What's that? That is a feeling that she should be able to control your life.
Yes.
She should be able to tell you what to do. She's not asking you for your help. She's telling you, you have to help her, otherwise, that's what she's telling you.
I'm going to get mean and nasty.
You're going to get really nasty instead.
Okay.
That's what she's telling you. Many of you do this. Many of you do this. You have to help me. If you don't help me, I'm going to get nasty with you. That's not a request. What's that? That's a... Not only a demand, that's an order. And you think you're living in many of you think, who do this, and many of you, by the way, have done that with me, have been ladies, have done that with me, and because you think you can get away with it, and you're not going to get away with it much anymore, but what I'm saying to you is that you think you can do it, and you believe you should be able to do it. Many of you have that relationship with your husbands, where you believe you should be able to order him around, tell him what to do, and in fact, if he doesn't, you lay down the law. That's it. No sex for you. No this, no that. You know what I mean? It's all like cut off. And of course, it gets them back into line many of the times. So I don't get back into line. Sorry. Once you cut these bridges, you're going to have to reestablish them at some point in the future, not me. I'm not getting back into line for you. But what I'm illustrating from that is the lack of self-examination. You see, in that very first, Mary gave her opportunity after opportunity to reflect upon her own demand. Right? No self-examination whatsoever, just total ignorance, total desire to ignore any truth. And what we can't grow like that. We're never going to grow like that. Right?
Is it all about our mummy and daddy emotions that we've sort of concreted down, but now we've got Jesus and Mary, and we feel that they'll, you know, give us what we need? And when you don't, there's just this apocalyptic rage.
Yeah.
Oh, no, you know, not again. Even, you know.
No,
we're
I
just
agree.
Projecting.
There is a lot of those projections at us of mummy or daddy type emotions. However, can I say, there is no justification, no matter how mummy and daddy problems you have. There's no justification for your rage. And this is what we're trying to get across, is that there is no justification for this poor behaviour. Self-analysis is required. So if you're really angry with myself or Mary, you need to sit down and ask yourself some pretty good questions, because all we've ever done is provide things to you with no demand in return. So if you're pretty angry with this, you've got some big issues to work your way through with your mum and father, obviously, if you're pretty angry with this. That's the issue. What is it? Now, a lot of you want approval from mummy and daddy, or you want acceptance from mummy and daddy. You want to know that you're being loved. But they're not just what you want anymore. These are the underlying grieving things. But on top of all of that is all this rage that you expect it now. You expect people to do this for you. You expect them to act in a certain way towards you. And when they don't, just boom, like a big explosion. Right? There's no self-reflection in this. None. There needs to be more if you're really going to grow to God. You know, there needs to be more self-reflection in that. Okay, Alex?
AJ, can I ask a question about your treasure?
Sure.
Okay.
It's definitely on topic.
Yeah. say my partner and I decide, okay, we're in addiction, we need to go to God, work through some blocks to God, okay?
Yeah.
And so the first thing I feel is I can't connect to God. I have no connection to God. That's generally how I feel.
So how do you feel about that?
So it's what I do, I get angry about it. So I start...
Why do you get angry?
Because I feel abandoned. I feel like I can't have a connection to God.
You feel abandoned.
I feel like he's playing peekaboo with me.
Yep. This is something many of us do, by the way. You feel abandoned by God, right? Well, what's the truth?
Well, God hasn't abandoned me.
That's the truth.
And then I go into anger and I realise it's about my dad.
Yeah.
So I, you know, I let him have it. And then usually I drop into grief.
But that's not the truth either.
Okay.
Letting your dad have it is not the truth, is it?
What do you mean?
Well, you feel abandoned. That's the feeling, yes?
Yeah, he wasn't there for me as a kid, yeah.
Oh, okay, so he wasn't there for you as a kid. Do you know why?
Yeah, because he loved alcohol more than he loved his family and me.
All right, okay. That's your angry position?
Yeah.
Yep. And you're sticking with it?
Well, no, but I have memories.
Because that's not the real reason why. Why does a man love alcohol?
Doesn't want to feel his pain.
Doesn't want to feel grief. What is usually the grief about?
Feeling unloved.
Feeling unloved. That is his real feelings. He feels unloved. That's why he couldn't give you any, because he feels unloved.
Okay.
And he didn't want to feel that. That's his real... What I'm pointing out to you, I'm not saying don't do all the things you did.
Yeah.
I'm saying the truth is your dad has a huge amount of grief about feeling unloved. That's the reality.
No doubt.
Sorry?
Yeah, no doubt.
No, see, can you feel the anger with you?
But...
Can you feel the anger with you?
Yeah.
Recognise it. It's not, I understand why you feel it. I'm saying you've got to feel that anger with you.
I do, constantly.
And you want to hold on to it.
Yeah.
Why do you want to hold on to it?
But sometimes I get into grief and some stuff.
Sometimes,
comes out.
But most of the time, the fact is you've still got the anger, so you're still holding on to it. Mm. Why do you want to hold on to it?
I don't know. I want him to see that he created
all this. What's your treasure here? You would rather hold on to anger because anger gives you something that going into the grief about being abandoned does not give you, and going into the feeling that your father was unloved doesn't give you. Your anger gives you something that you will not get another way. What does it give you? Many of you have the same issue.
Position of strength, probably.
Well, what does it give you? It does a lot of things. You have an emotional investment in remaining angry. What is the emotional investment? What do you get to feel? You get to feel right. You get to feel powerful. What else? You get to feel...
blame.
Yeah, you get to blame someone else. Why would you want to feel all those things? Because they prevent you from feeling your grief of being abandoned. So I'd be working on my treasure would be to know myself. That's one of my treasures. So what I would be doing is I go, okay, every time I want to be right, I want to be powerful, I want to blame someone else, I want to do all of this kind of stuff, I am not engaging my treasure. I am engaging the blockage of my treasure. The blockage of my treasure. If my treasure is my feelings, my true feelings, which is being abandoned, then these feelings block me from feeling my treasure. Now, I need to feel the presence, but I need to understand if I am invested in them being there, I am not ever going to get to that. And most of us have deep investments in rage. We want to stay angry because staying angry gives us a lot of things that if we got rid of the anger, we would not have the ability to go back to.
But where do we start?
Well, my feelings on this issue is, why do you want to stay so invested in your dad and being in a rage with your dad? You've got to ask yourself why.
I just feel like that's where I always have to start. When I want to connect to God, I feel like I can't connect to God, and then it goes into that with my dad every time. And then usually when I spend a bit of time in anger, it gets into the grief of it.
Yeah, but as we're talking, you still got the anger. So that tells me it's not relieving your anger. So that means you're on the wrong track. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
You've got to be on the wrong track. If you're not relieving the emotion that you're attempting to feel, then it means that the emotion you're attempting to feel isn't the truth. There's something else going on. And what I'm saying to you, Alex, is that you have an investment in being angry. You want to remain angry with your dad. What does this give you? It gives you something. It gives you things that you are addicted to. Does that make sense? They are the addictions you need to address. What does it give you? What things does it provide for you? These are the things you're treasuring at the moment. You're treasuring what your rage is giving you. Right? Once you give that up, you'll find you'll be able to get into the feelings of abandonment. You'll have a much more childlike feeling of rage inside of you with your dad. And in fact, most of the time, a child doesn't feel much rage towards their parents. Generally, they just feel huge amounts of, grief and fears, really. And what rage also gives you is an inability to go towards your fear, what you're afraid of. Things like, I'll never be loved. If my father couldn't love me, then God will never be able to love me. You know, there's all these kind of feelings and beliefs that can be exposed. But while you want to be angry with that, and you need to face that you want to be. Does that make sense? You need to be honest. I want to be. I want to keep this anger in me for the rest of my life until he changes, until he apologizes to me, until he tells me that he did the wrong thing. And even then, I'm going to make him have a good ball about it first and do some correction first before I'm going to forgive him. And I want that to happen. Until we recognize these emotions inside of us, we won't find the addiction, which is the addiction to remaining in a rage. Many of us have strong addictions to remaining in a rage. That makes sense?
Yeah. Well, the reason I'm asking is because I've gone through that process a number of times and I still don't feel any closer to God. So I'm thinking, there's got to be something wrong here.
Of course. That's what I'm saying. You cannot go through a process of untruth with God. You have to face the truth that you want to be in a rage with your father. you want to be. That's the truth. So that's the truth you need to start with God. Does that make sense?
I feel like I've had to be in order to get into the grief.
You want to be.
Yeah. All right.
There's a big difference between have to, want to. You want to be in a rage with your father. How many of you, honestly, with yourself, you feel like the people that have hurt you, you would love to be able to stay angry with them? Because we need to be honest. Most of us feel that way, right? We'd love to stay angry with them. To be at one with God, you'll get to the point where you're going to not stay angry with them. How many of us want to give that up? Not me. I'm not giving it up. I'm not giving it up. God's got to come about to my way of thinking. What did you say? The potter and the clay? No, I'm the potter. You know, like, I want God to be the clay. You know, I want God to come around to my thinking. God can't come around to our thinking. This is where many of us are not being honest about the feeling, the true feeling within us. We select a group of feelings because we're told that we need to feel. We select a group of feelings that we prefer. And we avoid a group of feelings that we hate, that we prefer to not have to feel. We avoid them. And so we go into the feeling, go into the feeling, go into the feeling, go into the feeling, and we repeat ourselves for a year. And after a year, we go, we're not changing. Yes, you're not changing because you're on the wrong feeling. The law of attraction is telling you, if you're not changing, if you're not changed once you've got into some of this emotion and something hasn't changed inside of you, then it's not the right emotion. Well, you know, it's a different emotion. Most of us have a huge feeling that we want to remain in a rage with the people who have harmed us. By the way, we even want to maintain a rage with the people we imagined harmed us, not just the people who have actually harmed us. Thanks, Natalie.
So when you go from... because I totally recognise that rage you're talking about, and it's a very punishing... I feel like I want to punish the people that have hurt me.
Mm-hmm.
And yesterday I had an experience where I felt, for the first time, I just didn't want to punish my mum anymore. I accept that she's hurt me. I accept that she didn't know any different. It doesn't excuse what she's done.
Mm-hmm.
But the pain is mine.
Yes. And only you can feel the pain.
Yes. And no amount of suffering that I cause her is going to ease that pain in me.
That's right. Yeah. And you can return as much suffering as you can imagine. And many people, by the way, do this in their life. They return as much suffering to the people who cause them to suffer as you can imagine. Many of them even do more than that.
So when you, through that self-examination process, is that where you go from a place of making someone else, and all women in this case, responsible for my pain, to actually just accepting, well, no, it's my pain and
yes,
I need to deal with it?
Every time we are placing the burden of our emotion on somebody else, whether it's a neediness, rage, anger, blame, whatever it is, we are avoiding the fact that they can't feel our emotion. No matter what pain somebody has caused you, it's highly unlikely they will ever be able to feel it because they can't feel you. They can't feel your emotion. Even when they become a celestial spirit, they're not going to know what it feels like to be you in your current state, you know, after they've worked through all their emotions about what they've caused to you. Of course, they have to go through repentance and all of those kind of things. And during that process, they'll be able to eventually imagine what it might have caused you. And as they go through that process, they'll have a contrite heart about that, but you can't expect any of that. You can't expect any of that at all. Many of you expect this even now. You want everybody who has ever harmed you to come to a recognition of their harm of you. You want to go through the entire process with them. You want them to do that before you're willing to go through the connection of what they've done. What I find is much easier is to actually go to the feelings of what they've done. Now, there might be some rage in that, but mostly there'll be fear and grief in that as well. It'll be very fast through your rage in that state. You won't go over it and over it and over it for months and years and years. It'll be like bang, 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 30 seconds, you're into the next step, right? And you might have that happening a fair few times. If you've got extreme amounts of damage that's been done to you, you might need to do that for a week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks at the most, generally, where you go bang, bang, bang into the rage. Now, it just depends on how much you do it in a day as to whether you get there in the end. Most of us don't go there because we can't even admit to ourselves that we really want to kill our mothers, for example. Or better, do all the things they did to you back to them and a bit more so that they can feel it. That's what many of us have in us, that kind of emotion, right? And we need to recognize that that is an addiction to avoiding a lot of our personal feelings.
Yep. It's a nice feeling to not want to punish someone too.
Yeah, once you get to that state, you start, and it's also a very soft feeling towards yourself. You start having a lot of compassion for yourself. You can actually grieve a lot of things in that state because you know you can feel inside of yourself what my father, what my mother did was terribly wrong. They had no right doing it. But you also have a very strong feeling inside of yourself of love for yourself that you had to endure that terrible behaviour. And once you allow yourself to feel that, then you connect to your own feelings of grief and so forth. Yeah? You know, like all Mary had to say to me the other day for me to go into an emotion was, how you get treated is brutal. And I was in my emotion. Just one statement, right? Because if you're soft to it all, you don't have to go through all the rage and all those kind of things that is this adult rage. There is childhood rage that you're going to have to experience, but it won't be like the adult rage. Yep. Okay, can we proceed? Because there's more. Sounds like a television ad now, doesn't it? You know those ads that come on at midnight or whatever it is? They go, but wait, there is more. We have to be very careful of dishonesty with ourselves. It is the worst possible thing for your development. Okay, here's another one. This one's for most of you to contemplate. We've mentioned this yesterday, but I'll put down some figures. The average person would pay around $10 when they go and get a cuppa. I don't know about you, but you know, do you still like the like a soy chai latte or whatever it is? I don't know, hot drink or whatever that you might get, a cool drink. You pay about $10 if you get a snack and a drink together or something like that, wouldn't you? How long does it take you to polish it off? Usually 15 minutes max. 15 minutes, you got a cold cuppa, right? So it'd be 15 minutes. So that's for 15 minutes. So if we did it as an hourly rate, we're basically saying that a cuppa is worth $40 an hour to us. That's pretty pricey, eh? Most of you probably haven't analysed it that way. That means it's worth quite a lot, right? Like, how many of you earn $40 an hour? How many earn $40 an hour? Hardly any of us here, okay? So that means that most of us are willing to pay for a cuppa more than what we are willing to pay for our time. It's an interesting statement about an addiction, isn't it? Okay, and a sense of worth. Okay, so we value a cuppa at around, it's $40 per hour. The average person donates around $10 for 4 hours of divine truth. So what's that per hour? So it's $2.50 per hour. Okay. And that's, of course, without expenses or anything else. And this is without expenses. This is like the value. Okay. So what's that over that? How many? 16 times. Most of us value a visit to the coffee shop 16 times higher than what we value hearing divine truth. Isn't that interesting? Why? Can you tell me why? Where is our heart? Where is our treasure? Yep. Want to have a stab, Eva?
Thanks. My first observation is that they often do it more than once a week anyway.
Yes.
And the second is that that's because it's an addiction, so they're really...
Okay, so this is often happening more than once a week.
Mm.
And the reason why is because it makes us feel certain
good.
Things
mm.
that divine truth can't make us feel.
Yep. Yep.
It's the same thing. It makes us feel things that divine truth... Can you see our willingness to even pay more than what we think we're worth for something that is perishable, as I said in one of the quotes in Luke, right? Perishable, here today, gone tomorrow. Here today, gone in 15 minutes. Into there, you might get a few more minutes of satisfaction out of it, and bang, she's gone out the other end. Right? Nothing now comes from it.
Thank you.
And we're willing to pay 16 times more for that than we are for divine truth. Why is that? Because there are obviously heavy addictions involved in getting the cuppa. Does that make sense? So this tells me there's a lot of feelings that I'm getting from my cuppa. What do you get from your cuppa? What do you get from when you... What draws you to go to the coffee shop? I'm not saying don't do it. I'm saying what do you get from it? Yeah, Jason, let's go.
The social aspect where you're connecting with another human being.
Big thing, isn't it? Social connection. Yeah, a feeling that I belong somewhere, that I'm sharing my life with somebody. We're doing something together. It makes us feel together. It makes us feel like we're wanted. It makes us feel like we're needed. It makes us feel like everything's fun together. Yes, Max, you had an idea? And then we go back to Keith.
Relaxation.
What's that?
Relaxation.
Okay, we have such a stressful life that we need badly that 15 minutes of relaxation, right? We can't do without that, kids.
It's been my experience in my business that if you give something to somebody for free, they always seem to value it or question it. To them, it's questionable.
Yes.
I think you give your time and all your effort for free. I can't help presuming that a lot of people just find that questionable, whereas if they go and buy a cup of coffee, they feel they've paid for it, so they deserve to enjoy it.
So there is a suspicion with divine truth that doesn't exist when you go and get a cup of coffee.
It's because they paid for it.
They've paid for it, so there's no suspicion anymore.
Yes.
It's not like, what's he going to want later? So you don't go to your coffee house and go, oh, yeah, I'm paying $40. What are they going to want from me next? Right? Because you've paid for it and you don't have a feeling of suspicion about it. But with divine truth, when people give it for free, you go, what do they want really? Right? And so that is this one has a heap of negative connotation to it, doesn't it then? A heap of suspicion. Whereas this, no suspicion. I know that I pay my money, I get my result, there's no strings attached. And that's what I want. So there's a fear of strings being attached to this other. Yes? Make sense? Thanks, Sheridan.
I get to disconnect from how I feel and have a more energetic feeling and feel happy.
Okay, you need to get a bit pumped up, right? Don't you? Right? Gives you a feeling, look. But also, there's some good feelings that come from it because you have a feeling for 15 minutes that you're looking after yourself, that you're caring about yourself. Right? The trouble when you come along to divine truth and you hear all this stuff, there's another self-examination, another self-examination. And after a while, you start to be self-attacking, right? And then you go, then you're not caring about yourself anymore, right? So here you get to feel like you're being cared for. And that's a good feeling. I think it's very good to be cared for. But you can see we have an addiction, obviously, to that. We're willing to pay more than we are worth for that. Tim, thanks.
You might need to treat yourself because you had a bad week.
Yeah, sometimes, you know, you have a heavy week, and it's getting heavier and heavier. And you get to the point where you go, stuff everything. I just go and go out, spend some money on myself and make myself feel good again. And that is an avoidance of quite a lot of pretty negative emotions that you'd probably be better off crying about, and then you'd probably feel pretty good anyway. So what I'm illustrating this, because there's more I'd like to cover with you, is there's a whole group of emotions that get satisfied, right? You get to feel this whole group of emotions from the payment of that $40 per hour. They are not the same emotions you get to feel when you pay this. And so therefore, there is far less willingness to give the gift towards this than there would be towards this. Does that make sense? That tells us what we treasure. What are we treasuring? Our addictions. We treasure our addictions. We've got to be honest with ourselves. We treasure and nurse them. We like treat them like little babies. We rot them in our arms, our addictions. And many of us think, oh, I want to get rid of that addiction. No, no, it's not like that at all. What we want to do is rot the addiction in our arm and go, there, 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 there. And that's what we want other people to do to us too, you know, rocking their arms, you know, there, there. And that's the way we are with a lot of our feelings, you see. And whoever will do that for us, we give them the most things. We give them more of our time, we give them more of our resources, we give them more of our funds, we give them more of ourselves many times because they're giving us that feeling. How many of you have paid $5,000 for a weekend course? Any of you done that? How about $2,000 for a weekend course? If we just keep your hands up, yep, I've done both of those things. How many of you paid like $1,000 for a weekend course? $500 for a weekend course? Right? Why did we do that? Because the addiction involved in what we got from it, we felt was worth that. Divine truth is free. That's how much you have to pay. Right? Free. It's going to change your life forever. And yet we're willing to spend $5,000 on a weekend course or $2,000 or $1,000 on a weekend course and $2.50 for our $10 for a divine truth course. And I'm not suggesting you have to pay any more. I'm just saying compare it for the sake of looking at your treasure. What do you treasure? You see, it's demonstrating your treasure. Yep, Matt?
I can appreciate what you're saying, but AJ, there has been times where divine truth does not reveal treasures about myself. And so if coffee was to reveal the same thing, I'm pretty sure I would start to devalue it pretty quick. But there are also times when that does reveal really beautiful things that I didn't know about myself.
Well, isn't that part of the problem? With divine truth, we're often getting to hear things that we believe are so negative that we'd just rather not hear it. So, you know, who wants to come up and talk to AJ? What a terrible thing to do. But I know many of you, like, we get people like this, and honestly, this happens very regularly, knock on our door. They knock on our door, and they go, and we open the door, and they're shaking. We say, why are you shaking? I'm terrified to be here. We'll go somewhere else then. It's just shaking, like, my feelings are like, we are often so terrified to receive truth. And do you know what? When I've received truth, I just go, thank you for telling me something that's true. Like, it could have taken me years to find that out. Why would I not want it? And if you feel about it many times, in personal interactions you have with me, many times you have a deep amount of fear about what I'm going to say. What's he going to say to me now? What's he going to do now? Deidre had that earlier when I said about the examples here. Is she going to use my example? Isn't that how it is? We are so worried about hearing the truth about ourselves because we're used to being judged by it so much, right? So I don't feel any sense of judgment for any of these things. I do feel a strong sense that I need to state the truth of them because if I state the truth of them, there is the ability for the person to change. But I don't feel any judgment towards the person. You know, I understand in many cases far better than they do often when I'm feeling their feelings. I often understand far better than they do why they feel the way they do or why they're acting the way they do. But the exposure of the truth is the important thing. If I am resistive to personal truth, how am I ever going to change? If you're afraid to hear about yourself honestly and truthfully from anyone, then you might as well just say, all right, I'm giving up any growth. Because the reality is you'll never grow unless you hear the truth from someone, usually. Or you could hear the truth from yourself. That's sometimes a bit more pleasant, an opportunity. But can you see how many of us are so afraid of even doing that because we're afraid of what we'll see that we don't even want to hear the truth from ourselves? Now, can I suggest to you that hearing the truth from God is the easiest thing to do, not the hardest. Hearing the truth from yourself is the next easiest things to do. And hearing the truth from other people is a lot harder generally, right? And yet the majority of us never listen to the truth from God, and so God's got to send us another person. We never listen to the truth that can easily come from ourselves through some self-examination, and so God's got to send us another person. And so we finish up causing a situation where we are putting ourselves in a position where that is the most difficult for us to absorb the truth. We could be choosing to look at ourselves more honestly and truthfully individually rather than having to go through all that process. Yeah?
When looking at personal truth, you sometimes discover things about yourself that shock you and rock your very core.
I agree, but I don't ever see the reason for being afraid of them. Because they're always going to end up with me in a better state, with a better character.
Of course.
Yeah.
But my question is, why then is it... I find that some of those yucky things about myself are easy to accept, but then when I am asking for God's truth, I'm struggling to accept how God sees it. Because yep. That is the truth. That is the divine truth you're talking about, and I would rather hold on to the negative aspect.
So look at the addiction to holding on to the negative aspect. And a lot of that comes from the addiction to please mummy and daddy.
Okay.
To take on their opinions rather than taking on God's opinion.
Okay.
What do you get out of that? You get mummy and daddy's approval, you get their acceptance, and you get them not projecting rage at you. So you get a lot of things out of that. That's the addiction. That's your payoff.
Okay.
Now, many of you have probably done some psychological work at some point or read some books about psychology. You understand there is such a thing as a payoff. You get payoffs for all sorts of things. My suggestion is to look at your payoffs. Why do you want to only accept the bad things about yourself, for example? There's a payoff. Why do you only want to accept good things about yourself? There's a payoff. There's a payoff in either direction. Right, let's look at the next situation, shall we? I'm just going to have a bit of a cough. Okay. Now, I've repeatedly said over and over again that any feelings you have of frustration, annoyance, anger, rage, resentment indicate an addiction that is present inside of the person who still wants to be satisfied. You've heard that from me probably in probably 50 different discussions in probably 100 different ways, right? Now, many still get angry with myself or Mary whenever we hear a grain of truth from us, right? Or whenever we even hear a grain of truth from anyone, we get angry with them. Now, this is an indication that many of us still treasure our addictions more than we treasure the truth. I'll give you an example. Here's a phone call with Mary that happened last week. A man called and said, "I'm facing my fears, asking you to channel for me." Mary said, "I don't feel like doing any channeling for you because there's so much demand and expectation coming out of you towards myself and AJ all the time. I just don't feel like I can comfortably channel for you." The man goes, "Okay." And then Mary says, "Now you're angry with me as well." He says, Well, I don't feel that I'm angry with you. I'm shaking like a leaf and I'm afraid. And Mary says, well, I don't feel like you're afraid at all. I feel that you're angry. And he said, well, I'm afraid. And I'm facing my fears calling you. And Mary said, well, we have to disagree on the emotion that you feel, because I don't agree with that at all. And we're allowed to disagree, and I'm going to go now. Now, he came along yesterday to the seminar. And while Mary began speaking and was talking for a while, he projected rage at her for the first 15 minutes. I felt it coming through the back of me when I was sitting down listening to Mary. For that reason, I said to Mary that we need to remove him from our audience, and we asked him to leave. Now, what's the problem? What's the treasure? Jen, we'll have a go.
The justification of anger. That anger's okay.
There's a justification of anger, yes. What else? Monique, perhaps, if we go, and then Jen. Go, Monique. Monique.
I'm the feeling that we always can get what we ask for, that we deserve, an expectation that others do for us.
Sorry, enlighten me again.
The treasure is that I always get what I ask for.
Like a demand that I should get what I've asked for.
Yes.
It doesn't matter what the other person's life is doing or what they feel, I should still get it.
Yes, and in that I'm more important than them.
Yes, you are actually believing that you're more important than them. That is very much what this man feels, that he is far more important in this case than Mary. Jen? No? Yep, so thanks, Anna.
The feeling that I know what my emotions are.
Yes, the feeling that I know what my emotions are. How dare you say to
and
me
you're wrong.
That I have a different emotion than what I'm saying. Yeah. Good. Jen, in the front. Thanks, Jennifer.
I can relate to this one. His feeling that anger is not acceptable, so I'm telling you it's fear.
Yes, yes. His feeling that he knows from his own past and development that anger is not a good thing to project to somebody, so he denies that he has any anger at all when he's full of rage. This man is very regularly being in a rage with either myself or Mary, or both of us. Yep. So there's a huge desire to deny the truth of one's emotions. Why would we desire that? Because we treasure our current viewpoint of ourselves over anything else. Now, I suggest to you that a person who treasures their own viewpoint of themselves over somebody else, or over somebody else's, what somebody else is saying, has no opportunity to grow. No opportunity to grow. They are not open to growing even. We've actually told this man that he is not open to personal growth at all. He doesn't believe it. He spends hours listening to videos and listening to presentations. He spends hours listening while he's working. But there is no desire, pure desire to grow inside of the man. So why does he do all of those things? What's the emotional investment? You see, what's the treasure? He gets to feel that he's doing something when he's doing nothing. How many of us want to do that? Where you get to feel like, I am doing something, at least I'm good at that. At least I'm good at this or whatever. These are often emotions that we're avoiding. Sometimes we feel so hopeless about ourselves that all we need to really do is feel that for a day or a few days and we'd be over that feeling. But we don't. We don't want to do that. So instead what we want to do is this other thing where we want to close down completely to the fact that we have any negative emotion inside of us while wondering at the same time, while our life isn't changing, why we're not happier, while we're still having huge arguments with everyone around us, and while we're still not connecting with God. It's like the evidence is banging us in the face sometimes and we're going, no, it's not me. It's not me. It's not me. It's got to be someone else. It's got to be something else. And you know, for many of us, we actually believe that God's got it wrong. We actually feel, you should love me. I don't want to love you on your terms. You know, that's the feeling we have towards God. We feel that God should love and care for us under all conditions, and God actually does, but we're not going to feel that love while we have these kind of emotions. We just can't feel them. I think I've given enough examples, perhaps. Do you think I've given enough examples? Or would you like more? No more. So the question I'd like to ask to you is, what would indicate that you actually treasure divine truth in your own life? What would you expect to see if you were looking at your life from an external perspective, looking in? So instead of you being in your body looking out, now you're like somebody else watching you. Imagine for a moment somebody's videoed your entire day and everything you've done in the entire day, you know, right the way from, you know, having the shower in the morning, what you've done during your shower, when you made love to your girl, whatever it was, or guy, what you done there, they videoed everything and then they played it all back to you. What would you expect to see from that video if you as a person were engaging the principles of divine truth in your life and actually viewed it as a treasure? What do you believe you would expect to see? So if we come to Igor, then we go back. Straight back.
Well, we'll see, first of all, relationships with people improving with your partner to start with. And
so if I can be more specific, let's say during the day somebody come up and confronted you, what would you expect to see on the video?
You're not acting in rage back.
Okay, so there's no longer any rage in return to truth.
Yeah, you consider if it's truth or not for yourself. Yeah.
So you'd be humble, wouldn't you? You'd notice your own humility.
Yeah.
That'd be wonderful. You'd sit, watch yourself and go, there I am being humble again. Wow. Isn't that so good? There I am being humble again. Wow. Isn't that so good? Sometimes I say to Mary, there I was being humble again. Wow, that was so good. That felt good. And you'd notice these things, right? You would notice these things about yourself. If you were truly reflective, yeah. If we go straight back,
You would see yourself preparing meals that were loving to yourself, and perhaps yourself caring for your environment.
Okay, so in the care of your environment, you'd notice, wow, I did another thing that cared for me there, and another thing that cared, and another thing that cared for my partner there, and it felt really good. It didn't feel like, I have to do this for my partner. You would see all of those things in the facial expressions, the love that you felt. You'd be able to, you'd see it. You know how when you photograph faces, you can usually see the feeling a person has at the time. Well, you'd see that all the way through the day, how there's lovely feelings coming out of you all the way through the day. Anybody watching would go, wow, this person's a lovely person to be with. Right? Yep, that's what you'd see. If we come down to Barb, and if we go to Elizabeth at the back, yeah.
I'd see myself being responsible for myself.
Okay, you'd go, yeah, there I was again. I took responsibility for that emotion. I felt that. Isn't that great? And there I was again. Look at me there. I actually paid for my own meal instead of expecting somebody else to do that for a change. And all these different things you would notice about yourself, wouldn't you? Through the process, yeah? Elizabeth?
You would become like little children, laughing. Yes.
So you would actually see the passion and aliveness in yourself. So instead of walking around like zombie, you know, you're like, what would you say? And desire, what's desire? Can you make my desire happen for me? You'd never see any of that, would you? You'd be looking, there I was again. You know, that's something I love, and you can see that I love that. And there's another thing I loved, and you can see that I love that. And you'd be able to see the expression of joy in your own face at those things that you actually desire and love. Yeah? If we come down to Peter, and then if we come down to Jen on this side.
I think you'd be very sensitive to any kindness or good deed or anything that came your way, and you'd feel genuine gratitude and appreciation.
Yeah.
And I think you'd you'd be like, if you really love divine truth, you'd be on fire and you'd want to like share it with everybody any chance you got. If there was even the faintest chance that they could be even remotely interested, you'd just go for it.
Yeah, you know, there's an interesting verse in the Bible that says that the fire in my belly was so strong I couldn't stop from speaking. How many times have you ever felt that? That feeling that you can't shut up. Like, I know I'm going to get myself in trouble here, but I've just got to say something, right? So you'd see that present in yourself. As the video's being taken, there's another example where that feeling of the fire of the truth that's inside of you just burnt brightly. You know? That it was a sign of the condition. Jennifer?
You'd see a commitment of time and energy to time for prayer, time for talking with God, time for feeling stuff.
Yeah, so you would be look through the time slots and you go, yeah, see, there it is again. I'm demonstrating that the thing that are most important to me is my relationship with God, and there I am demonstrating my thing. The other thing that's more most important to me is my relationship with my soul and the other half of my soul, you know. And there we are again. See, there I made a choice where I put my soul before I put other things. There I made another choice where I put my relationship with God before I put other things. Oh, there I made a choice of integrity, of character, where I actually made a choice based, and I had integrity and strength of nature and character inside of myself. And you'd see all of these things. How do you feel after you'd seen that video? You'd be walking around going, gee, I'm getting so good now. But it wouldn't be like a feeling of pride so much, but just a humble state of recognition that you're progressing. Wouldn't you feel joy in that state? You'd feel a lot of joy, compassion for yourself. You'd feel a lot of pride in the sense of that the fact is that you're engaging the principles of truth that you want to engage. Your life is reflecting it. It'd be so wonderful. Give you a lot of positive feedback, wouldn't it, in terms of what is occurring?
Yep. I also feel then that you wouldn't be so self-focused, that I'd be wanting to be more loving to others and want to demonstrate love to others.
Yeah. So you'd be saying, there I am again, showing that person how I really feel about them and how much I care for them. And they didn't even realise. Like, they thought that I was upset or something, but I wasn't. And I was showing them that, you know, I cared about them and cared about their life and cared about their livelihood, so forth. Yeah, Jennifer?
I feel I'd be more experimental with life. Instead of the way that I feel most of the time, cocooned in a comfort zone, I feel like I would be embracing and taking risks and...
Yep.
Engaging life.
So taking chances.
Yes.
You know, So when you live your life without fear, it's like some opportunity comes up and you don't go, you don't go all suspicious for a start. You don't go, I don't know about that. I don't think it doesn't feel right. No, I don't think we can go with that. No. And you also don't do things like saying to yourself, convincing yourself out of doing what you love. You don't do that either. But yes, I probably would like to do that, but when I look at it, you know, it might cost me some money and I might lose some money here and I might lose that friend if I do that, and that other person really wants me to do something else, even though I don't really want to do that. And you wouldn't do any of those things in the course of this day. You would be actually working your way through those issues rather than just pandering to the addiction. Dennis?
You'd see yourself growing within your desires. They'd be shining from you as you walk.
Yeah, let me read you a verse. Another Bible verse. It says, "But the seed on good soil stands for those with a noble and good heart who hear the word, retain it, and by persevering produce a crop." Comes from Luke 8:15. There are other verses too. I think I've got them further along. By the way, I'm almost there actually. Here's another one. "No one lights a lamp and hides it in a clay jar or puts it under a bed." So back in our day, we used to light lamps. Nowadays, you just turn on the light, right? But you wouldn't hide it under a bed, whatever it is, would you? Because you wouldn't have any light then. Instead, they put it on a stand so those who come in can see the light. For there is nothing hidden that will not be disclosed, and nothing concealed that will not be known or brought out to the open. Therefore, consider carefully how you listen. Good statement, huh? Gee, I said some good things back then. Luke 8, 16 to 18, that comes from. What I'd often illustrate back then was a feeling of we can only let our light shine to other people if we have a light. Yeah? And the only way we're going to have a light is to recognise what's dark within us and remove it. And nobody else can remove it for us. That's the problem. We have to remove it from ourselves by feeling it. Right? These are the steps we need to take. So if my treasure is to get closer to God, I will take the steps to remove from myself what causes my own darkness, and then I'll automatically be a light. And if I'm automatically a light, now I'm putting my light on a lampstand. I'm putting my light out for everyone to see. Everyone will be able to see it automatically. They'll notice it. They'll go, gee, you've changed a lot. You used to be a depressed, morose individual, and now look at you. You're so joyful and happy. What happened? And you'll say, you know what happened to me? I learnt the truth about the soul. I learnt the truth about God. It's just amazing what's happened to me. It's taken me 3 years, 2 years, 5 years, whatever it has been, to work my way through a lot of the issues. But man, I feel like a different person. I feel like a different being. I feel totally aware of what's going on around me now. I feel totally connected with what's happening. Before I wanted to just die half the time. Now I feel like I want to live. My desires are engaged. And they'll go, well, how did you do that? And then, of course, you're letting light shine. You'll say, oh, well, I met this Jesus dude, you know, and he just said, whatever, however it is. Or I met, you know, one of you guys who taught the truth to them or whatever. You'd say, and I read this and I read that and I saw this and I saw that and this is what I did. Why don't you give it a go? Why don't you try? And this is what I feel will happen once our light shines. Now, there are other parts of this outline that I could mention, but I'm going to skip over them. The outline will be present on the internet for you so that you can read some of it. I've also asked the question in the outline, what would indicate that you treasure Mary and I time or effort that when we spend with you? And there's a whole series of things there that we could go through, but I will leave that for your own self-contemplation. One thing I'd like to say, though, any sincere feeling that you have inside of you needs to be nursed and treasured and grown. Any insincere feeling that you have inside of you needs to be removed if you are ever going to become purely happy and also in a very close relationship with God and yourself and your mate. My suggestion to you is to just stop what you're doing for a day or two. And I know it's hard Christmas time to stop what you're doing for a day or two. Or perhaps after Christmas, when everybody's drunk, you might be able to do it then. You stop and be able to feel for a day or two. Everyone else will probably want to just be asleep or so. If you allow yourself a few days of reflection, ask yourself the questions that I put to you at the start of this discussion. The questions about how do I believe myself to be in terms of what is my treasures, compared to how am I actually with my treasures? What are the things that I spend the most time on? Give yourself some time of reflection. Allow yourself to contemplate. If you do this, you will become aware. If you become aware of where your treasure is, you'll start to contemplate putting your heart there in a new place of treasure. Instead of keeping your treasures as they've always been you will adjust your treasures and start looking at other places where you can put your heart. And my suggestion is, if you put your heart first with God, all these other things that you are seeking will be added to you. Now, I know that many of you have not yet experienced that, but you will if you put your heart first with God. The reason why you have not experienced it is because you've yet to do it, right? And what I'd like to encourage you to do is to give it a go. Put your heart first in these things, the things that are the important things. Not only your heart, because if you put your heart there first, the rest of you will go along for the ride and you'll spend your time doing it. You won't avoid spending your time doing it or do other things that are less important. I believe that if we made this our focus as a group of people, we have the potential to create great things. Things that currently most of us can't even imagine as our potential, right? But it's only going to happen if our treasure changes. And that's why I want to ask you the question that I've been asking you all day. And that is, what is your treasure? And that's the end of my chat with you today. Now, we had also prepared a lovely discussion about desire, which is, you could say, the next step to engaging your treasures, isn't it? And what I would suggest is that we have given a talk about desire before. It's called The Law of Desire. It's under the God's Laws series of discussions. My suggestion is that many of you review that material about desire. The reason why we wanted to discuss desire is that we believe that many of you are not yet engaging your true desires or even know what they are. And if you can't know what your desires are, you don't know where your heart is. Your heart sort of becomes like when one verse in the Bible it says, tossed about like the wave on the waves of the sea. You go from one thing to another thing to another thing to another thing with no definite purpose. So we'd like to encourage you also to contemplate putting at least one or two desires into action in the coming months. Things that you've been scared about doing, frightened of doing, that you just need to go ahead and do and see what happens. And let God refine you like the potter refining the clay and turning it into something. Now, there's a lot of things we'd like to talk about on that subject, and so we might do another presentation at some point over the next few months and invite you to that to contemplate that subject, because I feel it's such an important subject to understand about the rest of your life. It's important to know that without desire, you're not actually going to accomplish much. You're going to have a very mediocre life. And I'd hate to see any of you have a mediocre life. You want to have a passionate, desirous, joyful life, full of creation. But we'd like to thank you for your time this weekend. We know it's been a bit stressful, particularly yesterday, in terms of the dosages of truth that sometimes come. One of the things we also believe is that many of you are becoming saturated with truth. And what we mean by that is that you've heard enough truth without applying it that now it's becoming a bit of a drudgery to hear more. We would suggest that you continue, that you consider applying more of it, because then you'll find there's a lot of joy that comes from that. And we find ourselves that if we receive more truth and don't apply it, you get to this point of emotional saturation where you can't even really hear more truth. And we feel that many are in that state where giving you more truth is just detrimental. And for that reason, we're going to give you a bit of a rest, and we're going to wait for desire on your part to have another session before we have another one in this location. Does that make sense? So, you know, there's a site that we've created on called Eventbrite on the net. What's it called, darling? I think it's dot. Is it dash bright though? Bright? /divine truth, is it?
Could be.
Yeah, I think
if you go to eventbrite.com and search divine truth, you'll find it
on there.
We've also
got a list on there, of all of the places where we would where people have interested in who have registered interest in doing a seminar somewhere. And if you would like, here, the local region is on that site. And if you want to see us again at some point, register interest.
I think it's already linked on the Divine Truth website itself.
I've put it on the Divine Truth website, but I just can't remember what page I put it on.
How to have a seminar in your area. So seminars.
That's right.
And then how to request a seminar
events.
In your area.
Events.
Yeah.
How to request an event in your area, Yeah. So register your interest there. We're happy to go pretty much anywhere, as you know. But myself and Mary really are wanting a couple of months, we feel, where we're going to try to get a bit of rest. And we've been travelling 10 months this year. And so we'd like to have a couple of months home where we actually have a bit of time for ourselves. Mary and I are both getting into some more emotion now, which is great, and we need some time for ourselves to work our way through some of those things. So that's what's going to be our focus for the next couple of months. Understand that there's these God's Way, what used to be God's Way of Love Learning Centres, but Learning Centre activities that will be going on. We'll place the details of those on the net. We're also happy to have discs to copy for people of all of the data that are on our systems. Just again, please follow the instructions that are on the website about that. We prefer that you post them to us rather than drop them off, because every time you drop them off, we have to talk with you. And we really want to have a lot of time for ourselves. We would prefer to have them posted to us rather than dropped off. Or just drop them in our letterbox. It's a different letterbox now, because we had one stolen from us. We had some locals come around and steal our letterbox, so we put in a new one. And they didn't steal any of the things in the letterbox, so that was great. Feel free to just drop them around, or even just drop them at our front porch if you're worried about the letterbox. That's fine. I have the means to copy many, many drives at the same time now, so it's not much of a drama for us to do that. Make sure you're clear with the return postage and so forth, or the return address or whatever it is that you want to get it back, because otherwise we're then chasing you in terms of time. And as I said, myself and Mary are going to use our time quite wisely over the coming month or two. Our main project over the coming month or two is this Kenyan project that we're engaged in, and many of you have offered your support for that, which we really appreciate. Mary's put the details of that on her blog, so that you can see about that. And we'll be doing some things there that we've already began doing. We've sent the first set of funds to them so that they can start translating into the different languages, and so that's already began. Okay, I think that's the main things. Is there any other things we need to mention, darling? Yeah.
I'd just love to thank Lena and Igor and Yvonne and her support team just for putting everything together as
today,
usual.
And yesterday, yeah. As yeah. usual, and for the pack up they usually do. Yeah, that's lovely. Thank you. Would you like to thank them? The other thing I'd like to just do is thank every single person who has been involved in terms of an administration or leadership role with the God's Way of Love organisation. I feel that many people have learnt a lot of things in the process, and I feel we still have the capacity to learn many more. but we'd like to thank you for engaging that process with us. And even though it might not have been successful as we might have hoped, we feel there's quite a lot of things that have been gained from it. And there are many people as well that have benefited from your effort. So we would love to thank you for your effort and time. We'd also love to thank those groups of people, there's about 20 or so people who meet with us semi-regularly, who are involved in different teams doing things like transcriptions and answering emails and doing the editing work and all these different things. And we'd just love to thank you guys for all of your effort as well while we've got the opportunity. And wish, so thank you. And we'd like to hope that you have a good break, a good Christmas if you celebrate such things, and a good New Year's too. I think it's going to be a very interesting New Year's, huh? Don't you think? Yeah, I wonder what all the New Agers who are trusting that, you know, December the 21st is going to be the end of civilization are going to do when we go past December the 21st. There will have to be a bit of adjustment there, perhaps, eh? So that'll be interesting to see too. So we'd love to thank you for your time again and the energy you expend engaging with us in these discussions. And I've really enjoyed presenting for you today. And I'm not sure if Mary could say she enjoyed completely yesterday, but I think you did pretty much, didn't you? Yeah. Yeah, so we often enjoy it, particularly when you guys are honest and forthright with us. We love that, so thank you for your time. We'll catch you, well, we don't know when next, really. We'll see what happens. We'll catch you soon. Cheers. Thanks, guys.